All right, let's bring in our panel now. Josie Pagani, Director of the Council for International Development, Efeso Collins, Auckland Councillor, Kerry Prendergast, former Wellington Mayor and current Chair of Tourism New Zealand. Josie Pagani, I want to start with you while I make my way over to the panel. It is a tough job, isn't it, for Phil Twyford? This is not an easy task.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting that you didn't get a direct yes that they will hit that target of 1,000 houses by July next year. It is really tough. I mean, you could drive a truck through the pause when you ask the question about do you have confidence in Stephen Barclay, who resigned, and there was a long pause there. You could drive a truck through it. But it is really hard, Corinne, and I think it's easy to... It's been a tough year for Phil Twyford. It's a tough year for KiwiBuild. But you have to give him credit. You have to give the government credit that they're making this an issue, and the last government didn't make it an issue, and it's blimmin' hard. And so they've made it an issue. They've made putting pressure on local authorities to release land. All of that's great. That's bang on. I think the problem they have, and you heard it right then, you pointed it out, is the juxtaposition between the narrative about, you know, Michael Joseph Savage and state houses and, you know, opening the first door of a state house, and the sense that, as Jane Clifton put it, you know, they're building pizza ovens and gardens. This is sort of middle class welfare.
It's a tough one.
And I think that's where the problem is, that the narrative and the reality.
Efeso, what do you make of this? I mean, they're doing it. You've got to give them credit.
Yeah, and I think the challenge that he faces is he's lifted expectations. So people on the left naturally are going to say, look, we want to see them. It's going to take time. I live in the apartment complex in Otahu where there's KiwiBuild being sold now. So I understand that they're doing their best. But, you know, we made that decision as a family over 18 months ago. So I get the point that some people are a little bit scared, you know, buying off the plans if it's your first time. But, you know, MB said that at $600,000, you're going to need an income of around $114,000 to be able to service that over 25, 30 years. That's probably the concern for poorer communities. My encouragement to the government would be to focus on social housing and state housing, because I think that's where some of the greatest needs.
Kerry Prendergast, it's difficult for the minister. He's saying he can't comment because it's an operational issue when it comes to the CEO, but this is a very unwelcome development for him. He's going to cop a lot of heat on this, I would imagine.
He's certainly going to cop a lot of heat this week, and I understand, as I'm sure we all do, the position he's in. I imagine it's an employment issue and he can't say anything while there are still presumably negotiations going on. So I feel sorry for him, and I know he'll get a hard time in the House, and I bet he's hoping that Mr Hughes, the State Services Commissioner, sorts it out this week.
All right, as a former Wellington Mayor, I mean, 44 new places today, I mean, they are starting to come. That's... People are going to see that, right?
Look, I'm proud that we live in a country with a safety net. I've just come back from LA. I've seen the two sides of the gap in the wealth and the poor. 55,000 people living on the streets in LA, and yet we were in a part of LA where the homes are multi-million dollars. And although we're getting increasing inequity in New Zealand, we do have a safety net, and this government has got to sort out these homes and get people out of their cars and off the streets and into dry, warm homes.
And I think that's the point that you made, Efeso, that this is the problem they've got. I think if they focused more on social housing, you've got to ask the question, what is it that government can do that the market can't? And government can build social housing. And it does several things. I mean, one is that it stabilises rents. Now, high rents are one of the reasons why we have a housing bubble in the first place, because it drives up housing prices. And also, you know, you guarantee quality, so you are going to get people buying off the plans. It's a state house. And you can do schemes like rent to buy. And actually, Kerry, I think, I mean, you see in England the way that councils are involved in council housing. I think they need to really be transformational about this and have council housing.
You still have to have abilities for young couples to be able to get into their first home. So not just the social housing.
But
and in the past,
that
was always our dream, to own our own home.
Yeah.
And now that people have been land banking, they've put up the price of land, there's been issues around how long it takes to get a building consent, to get a resource consent, and the costs have gone up.
That raises the issue, Efeso, about how well this has been sold by the government, because it makes sense that they're building, they're filling that gap, that affordable market for first home buyers. That's a perfectly reasonable thing. But did it sort of, they sort of lost the narrative about that, that it was sort of all encompassing Kiwi Build?
Yeah, I think that the narrative's been, well, I was going to say stolen a little bit by the politicians, because there's a whole lot of
well, the opposition has been pretty effective,
and they have been. And so what they've got to do is get that narrative back. They've got to say, here are the houses. Look, when they opened, I think it was in Papakura, you know, there was the anti sentiment that was put out by Judith Collins around this young couple. So Labor have got to come out and say strongly, this is the benefit of being able to have an income level at this stage. We're building the houses, we're going to get out there. But again, it comes down to state housing. If they really want to win the left, they've got to put those 10,000 people that you're talking about into homes. We've got to do a whole lot better. Look, I was in the States as well. A quarter of the homeless people are in California. That's a complete imbalance, similar to here in Auckland. Yeah. We've got the bulk of the homeless people. We've got to get them into good, dry, warm housing.
And you can do, you know, you can do both of those things, where you can look at doing a sort of rent to buy scheme, or you can look at maybe doing more with KiwiSaver, where maybe as an employee you put in a certain percent and the government puts in more. Yeah. So you help people buy their first home. I think that's how you do the affordability thing. But I still think, you know, you're right. If you really do something big, like, then you are doing the Michael Joseph Savage thing. You're going, right, we're going to build houses. We can borrow money cheaper than anybody, any developer. Yeah. We can build them. It's still an asset on the government books. It's a win-win.
Ghettos. We don't want just huge blocks of social housing. We want mixed communities where we can have pensioners living there, we can have people that requires the support of social housing. We want young couples all living in a community together where the children can all interact, they can all go to the same schools. And so I'm not so keen on just social housing. I think you have to have both.
All right. You can salt and pepper it.
Let's just get a quick comment on Sir John Key's interview. Hasn't done too many interviews. Kerry, what did you make of him and his defence, I suppose, of the banks? Because let's face it, they've been copping it lately.
They have, and I think it was a bit of a cop-out by Sir John. They've made a huge profit, and when I look today at where they spread the largesse in New Zealand, there is some sponsorship, mainly in the sporting area. Interest rates are really low, so we're not getting it that way. Mm. I think if one in two New Zealanders are banking with ANZ, I think one in two New Zealanders would like to see a little bit of that $10 billion being spent back and supporting the arts, for example, and I've got a deal for him.
I'm sure you do. Efeso, he was, you know, he was sort of veiled criticisms back at Shane Jones. I mean, it's interesting because he's got the Air New Zealand role as well. He's clearly not happy about some of the shots that have come that way.
Yeah, no, he's not happy. But you talked about social licence and tried to get a definition around that. I think they've got to look carefully. Look, there's big money being made at the corporate end. Good on them, $5 billion. But I think New Zealanders will worry. There was the survey that was taken where New Zealanders are untrusting around all the profits heading overseas. But with the social licence, we've got to start asking ourselves, do we want local closures of the branches? Are we just going to be app dependent? And I don't think we're going to be app dependent. And, you know, ANZ up until recently had their tellers saying to people, look, by the way, it's great you've come in to deposit your money. Would you like a credit card? Can we top up something else with all of this money? Mm. So there's all of that add-on.
Do you know
they've
that
got to be careful around that too.
It's slightly odd hearing your former Prime Minister, who's been your Prime Minister for 9 years formally, talking about we and not meaning me, you know, talking about we as in we ANZ. And look, I mean, every former Prime Minister has a right to have another career. But you think about, you know, I don't know, Kevin Rudd's gone to run the Asia Pacific Policy Institute. Finally, he's got a job, thank God. You know, Helen Clark went to the UN. Now she's the unofficial and potentially uninvited advisor of the Labor Party here. So, I mean, it's good that he's got a job.
No, it's good that he's got a job.
It was slightly jarring.
We mustn't forget that in Shanghai and Beijing, nobody has cash. They only use their phones. There are no credit cards. You can even buy dumplings from a street vendor and you just hold your phone up to the barcode on the wall.
But
the reality is, yes, I know that for some, and I'm in that age group, some elderly, it's a big ask, but there are young people coming through. They expect to be able to use.
You'll always need a hub for government services.
We'll come back to the panel later.